Brethren, this hour, I will introduce to us the person, the brethren, the vessel that the Lord is going to talk to us tonight in the person of Brother Chad. God bless you, Brother Chad, to take over from me.
God bless you, sister, and thank you so much for the prayer. And Merry Christmas to everybody.
Merry Christmas to you, brother.
It's a wonderful blessing to witness under Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
2 days ago, our sister was preaching about counting your blessings. And I was really thanking God for his numerous blessings in my life, in my family. And I hope you will too. And more especially the blessings of Christmas. It's like Christmas is a time of love. Christmas is a time of sharing. Christmas is a time of exchanging gifts. A time of the families coming together to celebrate. A time of joy. A time of reconciliation. A time of forgiveness. But one thing that amazes me is that as much as popular as Christmas is, a lot of people still do not understand the meaning of Christmas. The world is trying to turn around or turn the attention from the true meaning of Christmas. Everybody is shopping. If you turn on your TV, it's shopping everywhere. I asked a lot of people before now about Christmas. It was surprising. It was discouraging, the answers I was getting. How are you preparing for Christmas? Oh, I went shopping. I bought an iPad for all my kids. We are cooking. So I asked them, what is the true meaning of Christmas? Some say, I don't know. Some say, time for shopping, time for family getting together. Yeah, I know it's time for sharing. I know it's time for our families getting together. But what is the primary reason of Christmas? What is Christmas? A greater majority of Christians are just Christians by name only. This wonderful celebration is still a mystery to a lot of people. My brother, my sister, what is Christmas to you? I want to talk about Christmas today and the joy of Christmas. And I pray the Holy Spirit will take control of this talk. And I pray that God, who has decided to use an unworthy vessel like me to minister to you, will send forth his Holy Spirit to plant this message firmly in the hearts of his people in the name of Jesus. Let us go back to what happened in Genesis 2 and 3. You see, God created Adam and Eve. He gave them dominion over everything he created. He had a right relationship with them. He kept them in paradise. They had everything, a place of beauty. Everything was available for them. They had peace, joy, happiness. God planted trees in the Garden of Eden. And he commanded them to eat. They can eat of every tree in that garden. But the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they are not to eat it. And God told them that the day they eat that tree, they will surely die. For here comes the devil The devil came and deceived them. And they ate the fruit. The same fruit that God commanded them not to eat. You see, there were two kinds of death, spiritual death and physical death. Because of their disobedience, they were spiritually cut off from God. They died spiritually. They were chased out of the paradise. And because of their disobedience, sin and death entered the world. And the heaven was closed against the earth. God finally heard the cry of man. He wanted to come down to restore mankind. But he had to take the nature of a man to come into the world. He had to come into the world through a virgin birth. But where is the virgin? Remember, the world was full of evil. The eyes of the Lord were going round. Remember the word of God in 2 Corinthians 16, verse 9. It says the eyes of the Lord is going around looking for those that trust in him diligently, that he will show himself wholeheartedly. If he should come to you today, if that eyes should come to your family today, will he see any faith, trust in him to pour out his blessings? Then the eyes of the Lord captured this young, innocent virgin who knew no sin. She was found worthy by heaven to carry the Savior of the world in her womb. What a great honor. And the Gabriel was sent out to carry out the message. Mary was perplexed at the greeting of the angel. She was like, what's going on here? Why all this flattering? And then the angel gave her the real message. He said, do not be afraid, Mary. For you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. Mary was more surprised. How can this be? Since I'm not married. It is impossible. It has never happened before. And it will never happen. It will never happen. But then the angel explained to him. He said, the Spirit of God will overshadow you. And you're going to have a child by the power of the Holy Spirit. Mary, in all her humility, said, behold the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be done to me according to your word. Isn't she a role model? Even though she did not understand what was going on, She didn't regret it, but she still humbled herself and accepted in obedience. She realized that was the purpose of God in her life. She trusted God and had faith in God. And at this moment, I want to remind each and every one of us that we all have purpose in life. We are not here only to receive. We all have a part to play in the promotion of the kingdom of God. We must follow Mary's example. And carry out our task in obedience. Sometimes it might not make sense. Sometimes God is trying to show us something. It might not make sense to us. But all we need to do is just obey. And then leave the rest for God. Some people are still running away from their own task. Mary could have refused the offer, considering the strict law against having a child outside wedlock, the shame, the humiliation. But she didn't. She trusted God, and she had faith in God. We pray that the spirit of Christmas will possess us and reveal to us our purpose in life. Saint Joseph and Mary, the Immaculate Conception, in obedience, made a difficult journey to Bethlehem. Mary was getting ready to have a baby. They needed a place really fast. They arrived at the inn. And to their greatest surprise, to their shock, there was no room. There was no room for them. But that was by the will of God. They were finally taken to a manger. You know, a manger where they feed a very poor place. A miserable place. A place where they feed cattle, sheep, livestock. You can imagine the kind of smell that was oozing out of that place. This is where the Savior of the world was to be born. This shows the level of poverty this holy family was in. But the patron saint of the church and the Immaculate Conception were filled with faith and love, not minding the ugly circumstances surrounding them. Notwithstanding the level of poverty, there was still peace and unity. A very humble family. Every family must imitate this holy family. And then the greatest thing happened. The most important person that walked the face of this earth was born in a manger. He is the center of all human history. His name is Emmanuel, God with us. His name is Jesus, for he is the Savior of the world. Our Redeemer, our Deliverer, our King. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Child of God, you must understand who is he that is dwelling among us and why. And if not, Christmas will be meaningless, and Christmas will pass you by. Bible tells us in the book of John 3:16, that God so loved the world that he sent his only son, that whoever believes will not die but have everlasting life. That Son of God is here. He is here to give us life. He is here to deliver us from death, from darkness of this world. Our Lord came to open the gates of heaven, which was closed due to the original sin, to teach us the way to heaven by his ways, and to show us the way to heaven by his actions. God has a divine purpose for us. And Zechariah understands this divine purpose. He was filled with praises. In the book of Luke 1, verse 67. He praised God for this divine purpose of God in our life, in my life, in your life. And he said, blessed is the Lord, God of Israel, who has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his prophet, who has been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to perform the mercy promised by our fathers, and to remember the holy covenant, the oath which he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him and all the days of our life. He found himself praising God. He was rejoicing. He was happy. This is a prophecy. And from this prophecy, we see that God has come to deliver us from sin, from fear, and from death. But most importantly, from sin. Because when you are delivered from sin, then fear and death has no power over you again. Now there's no need to fear Satan again. Because we are freed from slavery. Satan knows that the coming of our Savior means big trouble for him. He is a proud spirit seeking for attention, and we must ignore him. A lot of people got caught up in the snares of the devil. And this is a mistake children of God make, giving much attention to him. Jesus Christ is here. Satan has no more power over you again. Fear has no power over you again. Death has no power over you again. You are no longer walking in darkness, because the light is here. The enemies were defeating you before, but now you start defeating them now. Satan was running the show before now, but now you are the one running the show, because Jesus now lives in you. Jesus is here. This is the time of rejoicing. Oh, thank you for Christmas. Rejoice, child of God, rejoice. I say to you again, rejoice. My brother, my sister, this is a time, a joyous time A time to rejoice. A time to thank God, to praise God for His mercy, for sending His Son in our midst. Do you know, my brother and sister, do you know that at the mention of this name, Jesus, Satan is in trouble? This is Christmas for you. Powerful. We need to sit down and meditate on the Christmas, the benefits of Christmas, what Christmas is all about. The time of empowerment. It's the time that you call on the name of Jesus. Your trouble is in trouble. 3 years ago, I was in a dream, and this man came to me. He came to my house. He's somebody I know very well, and I respect him. But he came to the house, and he said he wanted me to escort him somewhere. And in that dream, my wife didn't want me to go. Because he's somebody we respect, my wife couldn't put much resistance. So I followed them innocently, without suspecting anything. Brothers and sisters, as we were driving on the freeway, all of a sudden he steered the steering to the bush. And before I could say anything, we vanished. And we found ourselves in the kingdom of darkness. The place we were standing, there was grass, a little green grass there. But on our right hand is millions of people in bondage. They're all sitting down with chains. Like the way the police, like when the police arrest you, the way they handcuff you with your hands behind your back. On the left side, the same thing. Millions. They're all dark. Then I asked the man, what are we doing here? And that was when I was having problem with my business. I was fighting the case, the federal government, about my license, my two licenses in my business. And he told me, said, Chidi, I want to give you a surprise. I'm like, okay, what's the problem? What are we doing here? He said, I don't like the way people talk about you. They say you are falling. Because of your license, your business is falling. People are laughing at you. They're talking ill about you. And I don't like it. So I want to bring you to this place. It's a kind of a small initiation. But I promise you, after now, you will get your license. And then your business will grow back and be higher than how it was before you lost your license. Ha! I was like, Oga, but you didn't tell me all this before we left. I'm not ready for this. Why did you do it? You should have told me at home. He said, no, Chida, I don't have to tell you. Nobody refuses this. This is very important. Your life will change after this. And then I tried to run away. They pursued me because there were two, but I could only see the face of one. They pursued me. I ran. They finally caught me. I flew up. The one followed me. As soon as I landed, the one down got me. So they held me, one on my right, one on my left. And then as I was struggling, there was an announcement. Quiet! The grandmaster himself is here. And they told me, hey, we have a few minutes. It's going to just take 1 minute. Now stop. Stop talking. And I lost. I lost my strength. All of a sudden, there's There was a sound in front of us. And you see this dark smoke in like a square coming towards us. That's a smoke, but dark. Coming towards us. I couldn't look at it. I was looking on the ground, trying to say something, but I couldn't. I couldn't look at it. Not that I couldn't, but I didn't want to. And then when that, whatever it is, when it got so close to me, then power came into me. And I was just telling them that, oh no, I'm not ready for this. I'm not ready for this. I'm not ready to serve Satan. Now I'm serving Jesus. And that's all. I wasn't even praying. I said, now I'm serving Jesus. And when I said Jesus, what I had was poo, 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 poo. It was like an earthquake. I was like, wow, what happened? And then that smoke, four corner smoke, tumbled. I was like, what just happened? And I said it again. I'm serving Jesus now. And when I said that, Jesus, poo, 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 that thing happened again. That smoke tumbled. And the voice came from that smoke and said, who brought this man here? I said, okay, that's the name of Jesus that's causing all this earthquake. Okay. Now, I started bragging. I said, in the name of Jesus, at the mention of the name Jesus, every knee must bow, every tongue must confess that Jesus is the Lord. Jesus is the King of Kings. See that smoke, that Satan himself, that was Satan in front of me. And see the voice. Oh, he was, you know how you put, how you want to, like you want to suffocate somebody. He was, oh, who brought this man here? Oh, take this man away from here. Who brought this man? Even the people that were holding me, I couldn't even find them again. They ran away because they're in trouble now. And that thing was trembling, crying. And then I ran away. Then I woke up. And I told my wife, and we thank God. Thank praises unto God. But this is the power in the name of the one that dwells among us. That's the power in the name of Jesus that is here for us. Brothers and sisters, there is absolutely no reason to be afraid anymore. There's every reason to rejoice. Every reason to sing joy to the world. He has done mighty, mighty things for us. But one thing that amazes me is that a lot of people, despite the great things God did in sending his son, a lot of people still choose to remain in darkness. Remember when Joseph and Mary arrived at the inn in Bethlehem? They were told that the rooms were all filled up. They were told that there was no space for them. My brother, my sister, look at that story again. Do you know who is in that womb? That is God himself. The same God that was in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. The same God that made heaven and earth. The Alpha and the Omega, the one who is, who was, and who is to come. The Almighty. And who is here now. Did God forget to reserve a room for himself? Because he owns everything. The world is his. Every room and every space he owns. But it was to show the rejection of the one who is here. The world will reject him. They rejected the Savior of the world. The Jews that he came for rejected him. They did not recognize him. The Pharisees, they are known for their dedication to the laws of the church. They fast more than anybody. They pray every day. You know what? They did not even recognize the Messiah they were waiting for. They rejected him. They have no room for the Savior of the world. What a tragedy. I have a question for you. I have a question for you that is hearing my voice today. Do you have a room in your heart for the one who is here? Or are you one of the Pharisees? The three wise men recognized Jesus. They were led by the star to where Jesus was. And when they saw Jesus, they bowed down and worshipped him. And then they gave him all they had. Very expensive gift. My brothers and sisters, it is only the wise and the humble of heart that will recognize Jesus. First of all, we must recognize Jesus for this Christmas, for the Christmas period, this Christmas season to make sense to you. For the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to make sense, to be meaningful in your life. First of all, you must recognize him that dwells amongst us. You must recognize that he that dwells among us is the Prince of Peace. The light of the world. The long-awaited Messiah. The unchangeable changer. Sorry. The bright morning star. The beginning and the end. The joy to the world. He that dwells among us is a healer. And he has come to heal our diseases. He has come to restore hope to the hopeless, to comfort those in sorrow. He has come to preach the gospel to the poor and to heal the brokenhearted, to set the captives free. Recover sight to the blind. Those that are oppressed, will give them liberty. He is the bread of life. He is the lamb that takes away the sins of the world. Child of God, he is greater than the greatest of all your problems. He is wiser than the wisest of all your problems. He is older than the oldest of your enemies and your problems. He is the way, meaning that he is the only path to eternal life, the route to your divine destiny. The book of Acts 4 verse 12. He says, salvation is found in no one else, for there's no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. He is the truth, meaning that he is the incarnate word of God, the source of all truth. And he is the life. He is the source of both physical and spiritual life. He has authority over life and death. So in times of difficulty, you cannot be afraid. You should not be afraid. Because He, the way, the truth, and the life is here. Secondly, after you recognize Him, you must bow down and worship Him. You must adore Him. You must praise Him. Remember how we bow down to people bow down to the elders, the Igwes, and the traditional rulers back home. Igwe, the Bada. You must prostrate before Him in prostration. You must fall down before Him and welcome the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Yes. And finally, my brothers and sisters, you have to give Him all you have. You have to open the doors of your heart and let Him come in. He desires to dwell in your heart forever. It is not about material things. It is not about money. He desires, your whole self. Our relationship with God is a covenant. It's a give and take. He has delivered us. He has sent His Son to deliver us from sin. To deliver us from power of darkness. He has brought hope. What have you done for Him? What have you to offer Him? If you are just at the receiving end, then it's no more a covenant. You have to let Him come and run your life. You have to let Him in. Remember the words of the prophetic word of Isaiah. In the book of Isaiah 9 verse 6. He said, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon His shoulder. And His name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Child of God, the government of this world is in chaos because they have rejected God. The government of this world is upon the shoulders of men instead of God. I have another question for you. Who is running the government of your life? If the government of your life is not upon the shoulders of the one who dwells amongst us, then your life will always be in chaos. He wants you to open your heart so He can come in and run the government of your life. Only then will He be your wonderful counselor. Only then will He be your mighty God that will do mighty things in your life. An everlasting Father that will lead you and guide you through life. And the Prince of Peace. He will give you peace in time of calamity. He will give you safety in time of war. Proverbs 18 verse 10 says that the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run to Him and are protected. When you open your heart for Him to enter, He becomes your strong tower. And when He becomes your strong tower, then He's responsible for anything that happens in your life. Even if something bad happens, then He's the one that allows it to happen for His divine purpose. Last week Wednesday, we were because we pray every Wednesday here. So last week Wednesday we are praying. We meet in the church at about 9:30. It's about 6-8 of us. And at the end of the prayer, Father Silas asked me to conclude. So as I was concluding, as I was praying, after praying, he stopped the prayer. And he told me that as I was praying, he saw something about me. He saw something. They showed him something. And that's a strong message. So he said we have to go back to prayers and see what was going on. So when he told me this, though I wasn't comfortable with it, but I know where I was. He told me that the enemies, first of all, as we were praying, I went up to the tabernacle. And I raised my hands unto the Lord. And I called upon the name of the Lord. He is my strong tower. And as long as I'm inside, I know I'm safe. I don't know about you, but I believe you are in there too. So after we finished praying, the Father told me that there are 6 spirits that gathered at the round table having a serious meeting against me. He called my name. He said, Chidi, they are about to strike again. They are planning seriously for you. Well, I went back to God. And I told God, you are my strong tower. I don't have any other God but you. So Father told me, like, to go to the Blessed Sacrament to put on candles, to pray. He told me things to do. When I got home that night, because of the prayer, we finished about 12 a.m. When I got home, I received a call from home. My cousin called me. He said in their prayer group, the head of their prayer group has a message for me that he saw my business. He saw fire in my business. He described it, where it was. And then they called the fire. We tried to put off the light, the fire. It wouldn't go out. So the fire service came and they put the fire out. And as we were outside, a man came out in front of me, was yelling at me. He said, this is nothing. I will deal with you. I told you I will deal with you in this America. This is nothing. So she said she called me, she just called to tell me, to give me the message. I was like, okay, it's the message I just got now. So we're praying. So the following morning, I called Brother Wakwe. And I told him to pray for me. And I gave him this message. But I told him that there's no way the kingdom of darkness will win this battle. Because I, Chido Nukua, is a covenant child. I know you want to go and charge. So the next day, that same day, I called Brother Wakwe. I went to work. Me and my wife were in prayers. At the end of the day, we are leaving the store. Me and the guy that work in the kitchen. We are at the door at about 9:15. As I was opening the door, I remembered that I have not anointed the place. I pray every day after work. I don't anoint it every day. I pray every day and throw holy water around. But that day, I was opening the door to leave. I told the worker, wait for me at the door. I have to do this. So I ran back to the cash register. I took my anointing oil, the one from this ministry. I poured some on the floor by the cash register. I was decreeing. And then I went to the kitchen to do the same thing as I normally do. My brothers and sisters, when I got to the kitchen, I was speechless. The pots I use for my nacho and for my cheese. We unplug it at 8 o'clock because we close at 9 o'clock. We unplug it at 8 o'clock and wait for it to get cold before 9 o'clock. And then by 8:30 we'll start to take out, start to clean the pot. By then it's cold. It's cold at 8:30. We'll start to clean the pot. But when I got here, the guy in the kitchen did not even touch it. He has not even touched it. He did not unplug it. He did not remove the pot to wash it. And this has never happened in that place. And there's no way no human being can do that, can forget that. And it wasn't even because of the cold. It wasn't even that busy that day. He was just sitting there. He was sitting there all for 30 minutes or so. He was just sitting there. And then I was just there. In fact, first of all, I had to finish my anointing. I poured the oil on the floor and I decreed. And then in me, I was thanking God. And then this guy ran from the door. He said, "Oh man, I forgot. I forgot to take off the list. I forgot." I was just looking at him. He says, "Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry." In me, I was thanking God because I know that this is a manipulation. There was no way anybody could have forgotten to do that. When I opened the pot, it was really hot because it was at the end of the day, the food was almost finished in there. And if I had left the place that day before 12 o'clock midnight, my business would have caught on fire. As I was driving home, I was praising God. I was praising God. I got home to tell my wife and my mother-in-law what was going on, what happened, to give them testimony. And when I got to the house, my wife had his hand on her head. And my mother-in-law, I'm like, "Ogini, what is going on?" It happened that my twins, the place they were playing, the life fixture, one of the life fixture fell right from above them and fell and sounded like a bomb and pieces right by them. It was like an angel just pushed them a little bit. And the glasses were all over them, all over the place. It was God that did this. The hand of the Lord was upon them, upon my family. This was just happening this last Thursday. And when I spoke with my cousin the next morning, he said that Thursday night they had prayer all night. And as they were praying, they were showed a man in an altar, evil altar, trying to send fire to my business. And then they were fighting it. They prayed almost all night. They came to pray for their intentions before they go for their Christmas holidays. But when they got here, they said they used half of the time. Message was coming: "Pray for me, pray for my son." And then they showed, they exposed them where they were doing their incantation to release the fire. And then they started sending fire to them. And also they saw evil eye looking at my twin. But God did not allow the plans of the enemies to come to pass. When he is your strong tower, when you run into him, he is responsible for everything that happens in your life. You must understand who is living amongst us. We must understand the meaning of Christmas, the joy of Christmas, that the Savior of the world is here, that the hope for salvation is here. He has done it for me, and he will do the same thing for you. I can see everything turning around, everything turning around, everything turning around for my good. I can see my enemies turning around, enemies turning around, enemies turning around for my favor. I can see your enemies turning around, your enemies turning around, your enemies turning around for your favor. Amen. And so, Father, I thank you. And so, Father, I glorify your name. I give you praise. I worship your holy name. I thank you for the gift of Christmas. I thank you, Father, for sending your Son in this world for my sake and for the sake of my brothers and sisters and for the sake of the whole world. Father, we say thank you. Father, heart of Jesus and Mary Ministry, say thank you. We say thank you for your goodness and mercy upon our lives. We say thank you for your mercy upon us. Thank you, Jesus. May your name continue to be glorified, O God. May your name continue to be adored. May your name continue to be magnified throughout the whole world. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. And by the power in the name of Jesus,
amen. I
that, O King of Glory, every door that is closed against you, every conspiracy of the enemy against you. Ah, King of Glory. Father, let every power of darkness that has, Father, encircled your children be destroyed by the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus. Father, King of Glory. Father, I consecrate this heart of Jesus and Mary Ministry to your mercy. I consecrate your children to your mercy. Father, King of Glory, God, may the coming of your Son, King of Glory, scatter every conspiracy of the enemy against our lives, every conspiracy of the enemy against our business, in the name of Jesus. Father, King of Glory, said you came that we may have life. Father, King of Glory, speak life into every family in this place. I speak life into our business. I speak life, King of Glory, oh God, into our marriages. I speak life into death born, every death thing in our life. I speak life, oh Lord, fight the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let us receive life. Let every death thing receive life in your life in the name of Jesus. Father, I give you all the glory, honor, and adoration, oh Lord. You are the God of restoration, oh Lord. By the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, oh Lord, let every man, every woman, every family that will open the doors for you to come in, Father, let everything begin to work well for their favor. Let the enemy turn around for their favor in the name of Jesus. My Lord and my God, I thank you for the Son like thee, O Lord. Heavenly Father, King of Glory, O Lord, by the power in the name of Jesus, King of Glory, O Lord. Father, I consecrate your children, O Lord. Father, my Lord and my God, the joy of Christmas, O Lord, will never depart from their lives, O Lord. Will never depart from their families, O Lord. In the name of Jesus, happiness will be their portion. Joy shall be their portion. Peace shall be their portion. In the name of Jesus, Father, I cover them in the precious blood of Jesus. I cover our lives in the precious blood of Jesus. My Lord and my Father, thank you. Thank you, Jesus, for this you are doing for us, O Lord. Thank you for coming to die for us on the cross, O Lord. Thank you for coming to save us from sins. Thank you, Father. Thank you, King of Glory. Father, I pray. I pray for those places, O Lord, that they have rejected you. I pray for those places, O Lord, that have rejected even our mother Mary. Father, release your power upon that place. Release your power against every darkness that is confusing your children, O Lord. In the name of Jesus. And those that have the meaning of Christmas, oh Lord. Those that have not understood that are running away from it, oh Lord. Father, King of Glory. Father, open their spiritual eyes, oh Lord. Manifest your power in their lives, oh Lord. That they will come to understand the true meaning of Christmas, oh Lord. So that at the end of all, oh Lord, the world may know you and know the power in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray. Amen.